The V-Force Youth Movement.
Leaders for tomorrow.
Come at the, as well as what ISAC is also doing, because I think both wings or movements are actually touching a lot of youth and impacting communities. So it's a pleasure being on board.
Thank you very much, madam. And today is a busy day for everyone involved in the corporate sector and the media. So thank you for, you know, coming online at this time, especially after the budget, and you know, talking to us about it. We have only 1 hour, so I'll get to the point straight away. In our previous program, we discussed a lot about how your personality and yourself has sort of your challenges in life have brought you to this situation or this level you're at. So let's start with that story itself, from when you were younger to where you are today, how you have been able to go through the challenges that life has put in front of you, and how you have been able to become the personality you are today. Your name is almost a brand now. People know you when they say it, and they almost immediately attach it to this powerful business personality, a female business personality as well. So this is a journey, definitely. So let's start with the commencement or the start of the journey itself.
Okay, so I think people have heard it, but let me try to give a view of it. So all of us in life, childhood, as kids, you want something, you have an environment you grow in. I knew I was good at sports and I loved everything outdoors. So as a kid, I was a tomboy. I played a lot in school. I was outside the class more than inside. My mom was one person who always made sure that I knew education was important, but she didn't curtail us doing sports, and my dad's side came from a sporting background. Now, what did I learn in this journey? I think as kids, I went through a lot of challenges in terms of, we were not from an affluent family, but we had a house and we didn't have cash where you have the luxuries. You're brought up in, you have to pick up. I think I had to take a school bus. I had to wait for the school bus. If you miss it, you had to walk to the junction and find another bus. You know, it's a simple life. But in these challenging times, and if you identify what I think I did, was I knew what I was good at. I learned to navigate the challenges thrown at it without complaining. And when you fast track a couple of years, what do you get in the process is, I think I got confidence in facing challenges. So today I know we are going through COVID and stuff like that. It is like another problem. How do we navigate it versus, you know, collapsing? So that was my childhood. Did I know? Was I focused in my, was I focused? I was focused and not focused. So what do I mean by that is, I knew I loved to play for Sri Lanka, so I was focused. I was not focused, and I also knew that whatever I did, I wanted to do well in. So again, I was focused. But I was not focused in my career. I didn't know what I wanted to do. So I think, I mean, there's youth here. Some of you all will be having friends who know, who say, I want to be an engineer, I want to be this, I want to conquer the world, I want to fight for human rights. Some of you all will listen to it and think, I don't know anything, what am I supposed to do? So I was one of those people who didn't know anything, and I preferred to just say I wanted to be an engineer because I'm good at math, and I didn't want to feel that everybody else knew what they wanted to be and I didn't know what I wanted to be. And imagine like the setting. So I studied in the Tamil medium, and the culturally, you know, the families also want you to study, and it's lots of focus on education. Imagine me trying to tell everybody, no, I don't want to, like, you know, do well in studies, I want to do sports. So it was that, but I still knew what I wanted to do, and I knew what was important to my parents, so I navigated it, and that was it. The next thing I knew I wanted to do was, I wanted to get married. So I got married, had my kids. They were the most precious things to me. I didn't have a full-time career. I opted out of it. But in the process, I was focused to get qualified. And when I got qualified, even I was good at my job. Whichever job I did, I was good at. So over time, I learned that if you make up your mind and apply yourself to something with an open mind, saying that you're willing to learn, you can pick it up. There's some things you will be really good and you like it. Some things you're really good and you didn't like it. For example, as I left school, I think some of like parents or other, so everybody else was doing a computer course. So I actually did a 6-month programming, C++, languages, everything. And I was top of the class. I mean, it came so naturally to me. It was so easy for me to do it. And I got 100 out of 100. The exam, I finished in half an hour. Others were taking 2 hours to finish. I was offered a job as a lecturer. But you know what? As I finished the course, I told my mother, I never want to do this class again. I hate it so much. So I was good at it, but I knew what I didn't like. Accounts was something I was good at, and I didn't dislike it, but I made it my own. So that's what I learned in life. And of course, when I became a single mom, I decided to go full time into work. And what did I have with me? I knew that I could manage myself. I knew what strengths I had, and I definitely knew what weaknesses I had. And with that, I also knew that I was not afraid or shy to integrate into society, and that came from sports, right? When you play in teams, you have different cultures, different people, you'll talk to the boss, to the seniors, juniors, but because of that, I didn't have this hierarchical thing. So with that, I actually could work as a leader. I managed to get the best out of people. And in the process, I was also pushed into different roles where I had to learn stuff, I had to unlearn stuff. And learn to understand people, learn to even think strategically, learn to get a vision and then give people to buy into it. So it's been a long journey. You only see a title and you see results, but it's a lot of change on adapting, understanding and managing myself, as well as managing people and understanding people. So that's been my journey. And today I call myself a career woman because my kids are big and they are no longer, do they need a mother like that to babysit them. So now I'm a career woman here. Yeah.
Yes, now we are talking about your experiences, and one thing that we have to also realize is now you are at a position where you see a lot of new people coming into the corporate sector. You have to work with a large, very large team, and all of these people, as you said, possess various talents, various weaknesses, various strengths. It's the teamwork that has been able to sort of, you have been able to bring all that together into one platform and then become the person you are today. Let's also talk about the leadership role and how you can work with people, how you can understand what your team members want, how you can amalgamate those thoughts into one objective, and how you as a person have been able to sort of bring all of this into unison and move forward.
So Chaturanga, that's a very interesting, complex question, and that's the biggest challenge a corporate leader would have. Simply, I think because humanly, each of us resist working together with teams. But the plus good news is the younger generation, I see they are more, they embrace teamwork better than our generation. So what I learned was in sports, these are again lessons I learned in sports because I played a team sport. And in a team sport, you realize you don't win, you don't become, you don't succeed by only you being good. You also know that everybody has to do a lot of hard work. We have to practice and all that is there. But I can't, just because I was a shooter, and the defense doesn't play, the team won't succeed. You need everyone to play their role. They also need to know how each of them connect into the strategy of the game. So that is one thing sports teaches you. If you all support the other one to succeed and do your role, the team would win. So the same thing had to get translated into business world. And I'll tell you, it was tougher to get translated because we are structured into departments. We are not familiar with fluid structures where you kind of working cross-functional teams. Now there is a lot more of that than before. We resist we all want to be leaders, or we think leader is a person who has position, right? So we kind of resist working under somebody else. We resist taking orders from somebody else. And I had to adjust a lot on my style to get people to perform. So technically, if you're working with a set of peers, so it was tough. So what I did was, look, I find it important that I lay the culture. So there's a big part of the culture we set up. So I kind of state that we are all here to, each one has a role. Once the culture is set up, I try to, me figuring out what the vision is and where I want to take at a higher level. I have to take time to understand each person's strength and then kind of put the right people at the right place. But most importantly, I have to make sure that they work together. So there was one instance when I took over a group, a company. They were the second biggest in the group. But I found that the Exco, sales would be fighting with supply chain. It was pushing back and being constructive is fine. But when you have disputes and fights and WhatsApp messages fighting, it doesn't work. So what I did was, I came back, I first told them, this is not healthy. I don't want this. And then one rule I had was no messages, no WhatsApps, no emails. Disputes, go into the room, you sort it out, and then you come out. When you come out, you have to agree to disagree. You're not going to, because you're having two views. Eventually, if you agree on one or you come to median, it's not, you have to learn to understand it's the best interest of the company. And when you walk out, you're not going to talk about it outside. Respect the decision made in a room and you walk out. It took time, but over time, now the team is each so gelled very well. They support each other, they complement each other, and it works. So it's not easy. It comes from sometimes being firm, sometimes also leading with change and making sure. So there are instances where there are projects. I will work under somebody else. I may be the boss, but I would still tell you lead and tell me what I'm supposed to do, what my role is. So they see that humility shift and with that they understand, look, it's okay to be working with somebody else and I'm empowering the other person to take some more decisions. So, and I'm okay with it. So I guess it's knowing what direction, where do they want to go? Secondly, understanding what strengths we need to have to go there, understanding each person's uniqueness and what they have to contribute. Then the last thing is actually getting them all to understand what we are trying to create. It's easier in a sports thing where you say you're playing against somebody else or you're having a timing, so you have a clear objective, which is seen. But when you're trying to create something in a corporate setting, it's very tough for them. You have to take time to take them through the strategic thought process and understanding where they want to go. So what is their role? So it's not an easy instant on the fix. You have to work at it. You have to make sure that people understand. In the process, some people might never gel within a team. Some people might never support it. You'll have to wean them off. Sometimes you take tough calls and wean them off and you take tough calls to step away. If it's a peer-to-peer call thing, you might take a call to say you walk out from a conflict. So these are things you learn to adapt and move on. So there is, that's how I work at it.
Yes, I know. A lot of these friends of ours who are joining us today are joining us from with a university background. So issues like, or challenges, if I may call them, like issues like sexism, harassment within corporate or professional environment, things like that. How in your life, how have you come across incidents where you have to maybe solve these issues? How do you approach them? And if you are a person from as a corporate leader, how would you advise someone to come and talk to you? How does that work out in your environment? And where are we in that?
I think as a country, we have evolved where corporates now they don't tolerate sexual harassment. But I must say, I've seen it being there in some places where people have spoken to me. Where particularly I didn't, maybe because I was a person who didn't tolerate it, or I would have been, my personality such that they don't even try to approach, or I'm not sure. on that side, I didn't really face it. But of course, I would see, I would have been in instances where you have lot all guys and only me, and they forget I'm there and they'll have a real sexist joke. So I had to choose how to react, because sometimes they actually unconsciously do it because they are not aware that I'm there. Sometimes they'll purposely do it to get a reaction. When I know it's purposely done, I react, and I'm very sharp in what I have to tell them. But I don't try to get angry and scream and shout. I will be factually, I'll give as good as I take. But most importantly, most of the times I find it harmless, and I'll say, excuse me, I'm around, and look, I'm not going to participate, and I'll walk off, smile and walk off, because I don't want to be part of it. But on sexual harassment, even though I haven't faced it, I've seen, we have a very strong sexual harassment policy, which has evolved over time. And that's to protect people from vulnerable places, either in the job role or from a community where people of power try to make use of it, right? And generally, I think I've seen not only, I've seen it around, that it happens purely because the other person gives in because of the pressure of either losing the job or something like that. My feedback or my advice is, look, you all have to take it on. You don't have to scream and shout and cry. You have to take it on. Take that the person who's harassing you on head on. You'll be surprised once you take them on smartly with poise, that and you'd show, showing that you're not going to tolerate it, people back off. If that's not going to work, you definitely have avenues of reporting. We encourage people to report. And of course, our group doesn't have that as a culture. So they are the women know that they are safe and they are thriving and growing. But I have seen years back, one or two young girls have come and tried to, you know, they've come and spoken to me, and we have taken it up seriously. So I guess it also happens from within. And the other side is the environment should lay the culture that you all shouldn't allow it. And if you are even not wanting it for yourself, and you are going to stand up for yourself and you want more for yourself, and it's not going to be, you're not going to tolerate any harassment of any form, I guess you should voice it. And one example I'll give you is, it was when I was within the group or within HEMAS, I didn't feel it. I didn't feel discrimination or it was not harassment, just comment. I was at a committee where I was the only woman, and I had just joined that industry, and it was a male dominant, and the chairman was a gentleman. And when I was trying to voice my opinion on something, I realized they were not listening and it was not happening. And each time I tried to comment, he was saying like, you know, Kasturi, wait your turn, wait, I'll come to you. And I kept on listening, and then eventually didn't listen to my opinion on an industry issue, and then came to the next topic. He quickly switched the topic about a dance and the industry chamber dance, and said, oh, Kasturi, can you organize that? And I flipped at that point. I knew they were testing me. And then I turned around and said, look, the way you all dance around the table, I'm sure you guys have a better capability of organizing a dance. If there's anything strategic and industry related, I'm good at. I'm not good at these dances and frivolous stuff. And I cut him there, and it was pin drop silence. But what I learned was, from that day onwards, nobody tried to pick on me on that. So you'll also have to stand up for yourself. And corporates now have, the world has evolved, and the corporates have sexual harassment policies, and they are mandated to be unbiased and to work.
Madam, the availability or the requirement of a role model for people, for these young people to look at, learn, educate themselves, maybe even follow, and you know, travel their path to become something that you can be or reach your potential in that aspect. How do you view the availability or the support of a role model?
So when I grew up, my role models were nothing to do with work. I admired Mother Teresa because of the goodness she did. And I admired my mom because she worked three jobs just to put food on the table. My father never worked. He was a stay-at-home father. So what did I use as a role model then was, it was nobody, but I would definitely motivate myself to achieve more. I knew I was happy if I succeeded. It was simple things. I took pride in doing well. So for me, it was from a match to a maths test. Or so I, even though I didn't focus on study, not that I was bad. I wouldn't want to be left back in the class. I just wanted to be in the top three. I was very competitive. So I was making sure I was focusing within my skills, within what I needed to do. I was very self-aware. I had to manage myself. But and over time, I realize now, but remember my time, there was no social media. There was no visibility and pressure of role models like that. If you had an aspiration to be somebody, you would have had a role model. So I want, my aspiration was to play for Sri Lanka and be a mother. So that was the problem. And I wanted to be a very good human being. So that was Mother Teresa. But today things have changed. Today in the presence with social media and Instagram and influencers, I guess for young people, it'll be very easy to follow the wrong role because of to be socially accepted as cool. And sometimes I look at these influencers and see what they're posting and I'm thinking, what are we telling our young kids? And what are we telling them to aspire to be? From an entertainment factor, it's okay. From an interest factor, it's fine. Nothing is wrong. But I would urge you all, while you admire people for whatever qualities and for whatever they achieve, you should have your own goals of what you want to be, what is the impact you want to be. And each of you have different unique capabilities. Figure out what is your own USP. And I always say, find your own mojo and your secret sauce and enhance that. So my secret sauce was being analytical, being fearless, being bold to try anything. And if I fail, I laugh about it and I pick up my pieces. I was not at all, I was zero creativity, but I admire creative good work. So I wouldn't, just because I admire a beautiful creative idea, tell me to come up with it. I can't come up with it. So I'll have people around me who are better than me. So I would say admire people and understand their journey and why they achieve that. But remember, your journey is your journey, and your roadblocks, your experiences around this journey would give you tools. It's like a toolkit you pick up in life. What I went through as a childhood, in my childhood, was a toolkit of having empathy with others, towards others. When people helped me in my life, it was a toolkit for me to play it forward. Getting into sports and captaining and working with people was a toolkit of hard work, knowing that there's no shortcut for improving yourself, knowing that leadership is not only a title, that you have to work with others. Then being a mom was a whole toolkit of, it's not about you, it's always going, your children have taken over your life. You will always put yourself in front of a bus if it's your child. So it's a life, right? And the day you don't have money, it's a toolkit of you learning to manage with that 2 rupees or your 100 rupees in your pocket, right? If you look at it of a skill you're learning. So in this whole process, I would urge you, look, you all have a journey, figure it out. Admire people for what they've done, admire their qualities, see what of those qualities resonate with you and see what are your skills. And unleash that. And I wouldn't tell you to mimic anybody because nobody, no two people are the same. I wouldn't say that. So role models have a place in people's lives, but that shouldn't be overtaking your life.
Now we are sort of talking about leadership and empowering others. Now, when you talk about this factor, then comes the question, what does empowering truly mean? Like, is it to financially, are you empowered? If you're financially, if you have disposable income, if you have money, basically, are you an empowered person? If you have a position where you can, you know, have a team under you and you can tell people how things are done or give, you know, instructions to people, does that mean you're an empowered person? What does it truly mean in your opinion to say, I am empowered, I am empowering people? What does that really mean to you?
I guess how I look at it is empowering is not that you're not giving a title. You are encouraging them to take on to unleash their potential or take on responsibility or a total responsibility. And you are making them, telling them, look, go ahead, you have the right to go and do that. And of course, there's accountability with it. It doesn't mean that they are going to be, with empowerment, you can't give it as a word. You have to equip them to receive it. So in a corporate setting, it's this. So you have to make sure that they understand what their skills are, and they should be confident enough. We should be able to give it to them and say, look, go about, make your mistakes, figure out the solution and come, because we trust you can do it. And if you need advice, you come back. And if there's an issue, and if things go wrong, the boss takes the hit. It's not that they take the hit. So where did I learn it first? I remember when I was in school, and our sports teacher, Miss Trixie, who was a games teacher, was sick during the All Ireland, and we had to train the team, on our under 19 team, and there was under 17 taking part in the All Ireland tournament, and the coach was not well. So the principal called me and said, Kasturi, can you take over and train the team? So, and I knew she trusted I could do it. I was all of 17 or 18. I said, okay, I'll do it. And I had to train all three teams. And at that point, I knew she had given me the empowerment, right? I was accountable. And then I had the past pupils coming in school to give us a practice with the goodness of their heart. And somehow when they were used to practice with us, they used to get angry and shout at the girls. And the girls came back to me and said, Kasturi, it's very tough to practice with these people because they are shouting, and then we forget even to hold the ball and practice, and we forget our skills. So because I was empowered, I went to the principal and said, look, I can do this, but my request is don't get the past people to come to school. We will practice without them till I finish the All Ireland. So she respected it, and she said, okay, fine, I will make sure that I do this and you take over the team. So I, at that early age, I knew I was empowered to do it. The same way now in a corporate setting, I get the teams to take over big tasks. I remember we were bidding for a huge a maritime big deal, but the young team around me were empowered to go and make decisions, because we are not going to be there to guide them every single step. You have to trust them that they could do it. Of course, they would make mistakes, but that's the point. At that point, you either have to guide them on understanding the choices they made, because I made more mistakes. Because I made a lot of mistakes, I've learned it. So the biggest part in empowerment, I thought, we saw in changes during COVID. Remember, corporates have huge structures, right? We have the CEO, we have MDs, we have directors, we have managers. It goes right down. And then you have the man on the street who is doing the most critical job for you, selling or looking after patients or manufacturing, right? During COVID, with distance and all the safety precautions, and the fact that you have to make decisions fast, we had to turn around and tell, look, the smaller teams take decisions. We don't have to come up the hierarchy to get an approval. So we empowered them, and it worked. But it means that we have to trust them as well. And trust is in two aspects. One is the trust that they have the capability of doing it. Secondly, we trust that they're doing it in the best interest of the company. So those two factors, if you do that and you let them go, and that's important. No corporate will grow if you do not empower and unleash the potential of staff, of your teams. Nobody will grow if you're holding everything to yourself. Tomorrow, if anything happens to me, my legacy shouldn't be that, yeah, Kasturi did well, but once she goes, Hemas is not that. I think the legacy should be that you empower people, you groom people, you coach them, you give them training, or you unleash their potential. And they do better without you. If you're there, and once I leave, if they do well, way better. That is a legacy I would love to leave. So that comes with empowering and trusting that they would do the right thing.
Now, madam, with our first half an hour gone, and Isaac has also given us a set of guidelines to follow in terms of the questions. This is an interesting one. So I thought I'll ask you this here. If you had a choice to change your career, what would you have done? What would you be today? That's a question Isaac has asked us. So I thought it was an interesting one.
Okay, so my first career choice, technically, I said I wanted to be an engineer. If I had known what it was about now, maybe I wouldn't have even said that. If I had a choice when I knew what it meant to me, I would have loved to become a doctor because I love the part of, because in healthcare, I love that impact. Of course, I hated bio as a subject. So you can see that it never went through. So I don't think career and what you like are, you like certain careers, but I don't think for me, I will change anything because remember, I wanted to do engineering. I did, and I got into physical science and I didn't go into uni because of bragging. Ended up being an accountant. And that was a career choice there because on simple reason, I had got qualified as an accountant. I was good at my job. I knew my double and I knew I was a damn good accountant then. But did I love that job? No, I didn't. So, but for me, it was when I went to full-time work, that was a career which gave me a solid income, safe income. I could come home at 5 o'clock. I didn't have to wait up till 12 o'clock. And I control that span, right? So once I got bored and I knew that I had better, could do more, I moved out of it. The first option choice I was given, I moved out of it. And did I? So I guess I look at it from this way. You don't, let's not pick your career choice too early because the world is moving. Play to your strengths. You have certain anchor points. You have to know whether you are excellent at that, whichever job you're doing, and whether you are loving it. You don't need to have both. So you may be excellent at it, but you may not love it. And that was what I did, what happened to me at being an accountant. But I knew I loved the praise which came along with it. When I went into setting up shared services, there I knew I was strong at processes. So I went into that career. Did I pick and say that, okay, this is my next career move and I'm going to be titled this? No, I didn't. It was just a skill set. So I guess I would look at your career, I wouldn't change it. Maybe I would have taken a different path. God knows if I had gone in as an engineer, I would have ended up maybe in the same path as this. But remember, whatever choice you're making as a qualification shouldn't be your career. Remember, that's giving you an entry point. It should give you a platform to understand what you're good at, what you love, and what you can be excellent in. And whatever you choose, remember, you need to be excellent in it. So.
Yes, ma'am. And I want to talk to you about some of the basically how a lot of young people are there is this sort of a, how do I say, a blanket generalization towards the youth of our nation, saying that we are afraid to take risks, or that certain opportunities are sort of left out for young people because we don't want to touch them or we are scared. And there is this, there are these stereotyping, there's stereotypes happening. And then I want to ask you, as a person who sees a lot of youth coming into the corporate sector, I mean, your company, you may have thousands of people coming into the system. Is this a reality? Are the young people these days afraid of taking risks? So I'm genuinely asking.
Yeah, I see. Yes and no. It comes from the fact that it's also why was I not taking risks? I asked myself actually, why couldn't I go into consulting? It comes from your background as well. So the young people aspire for more, right? And in that choice of taking risk and failing versus a steady job where you can actually earn something and one day take a risk is I see in one lot. The other lot who have a safety net of a financial backing from a parent are willing to take a risk because they know if it doesn't work, they can get back into something else. They have space. The third lot is that they might not have the financial backing, but they have parents who support. So recently I was in judging a youth awards, and there was this young kid from Goa, and he started this manioc business, but what we appreciated was she was packing it at home and the parents were encouraging him. He was taking a bus every day to Colombo. He managed to list his product at Cargill's. And he wants to do it. He took a risk. He's doing it from his house. So you should have your passion. If your passion overwhelms the and you passion to do it and overwhelms the risks, you will do it. So I was passionate about sports. So I took a job for 200 rupees at the audit firm. That was a huge risk. Who starts a career at 200 rupees in an audit firm which you didn't know? But my passion overwhelmed for sports because I was allowed to play sports there. So I went in there. My passion for my kids overwhelmed the money. So I stuck on in my audit firm and I worked part-time and because I was more important and my kids were more important. But when I went to full-time career, why didn't I choose the entrepreneur start path? And that was a choice because I was already a director consulting. At that point, again, my passion for my kids, I didn't have a safety net. So I needed a safe path. So I see the choices you make is based on the risk appetite you're willing to take based on your what you're passionate about. If you're really passionate about the project, you'll do it. Now, the younger generation, younger you are, take the risks. The older you get, if you have a safety net, you will do it. But when you're young enough, if you risk on certain jobs, go ahead and do it. So my younger son, who I could use as an example. He's a guy who would not sit behind a table or a desk. He's one person who always wanted to, he used to say, Amma, I want to become a mechanic. And I'm thinking, Jesus Christ, now what do I say? My child is going to become a mechanic in Sri Lanka. So I used to tell him, okay, now, oh, I want to be a pilot. I said, first of all, go get a base qualification. Right. And then we'll take this conversation off from there. So he did a degree in RMIT. He did supply chain and logistics. He loved it because it was all outdoor. He did all that. Then he got a job at a bank and he said, look, that's a job I'm getting in Australia. And I said, OK, what do I do? I said, look, try it out. No experience is bad experience. Right. So he hated that job. I told him for 12 months, do it. He collected enough money so that he can be financially independent to do what he wants. So for 12 months, he worked. After 12 months, he spot on 12 months and 1 year and 1 month, he resigned. But then they gave him part-time option. He still does 2 days a week at the bank because he wants the cash. So he was not willing to give that up. But on the other days, he's working in a garage. He's putting himself through a technical automobile mechanical course again during the weekends. And he's doing what he wants. So I guess, and you all might think he has a luxury and he may be having the safety net of my financials now. Maybe yes, but he's also a very proud kid who doesn't want to ask for money. So he's anyway struggling within that. He's sacrificing that 2 days a week in the bank, which he hates, so that he can put himself to college. So that's kind of the life tip. So I'm just trying to say sometimes you will, if your passion overwhelms you so much, go for it. If you're half-hearted, then look, choose what you love and choose what you are excellent in. And for me, I was also risk averse. And I see in the young youth who come into corporates are risk averse because I guess as a Sri Lankan system, whether it's our education system or our parents itself, we like that safe teacher, government job. Still, I'm amazed that people say, I want a government job. In Sri Lanka, the most unproductive sector is the government sector. And why do we want to put in the smartest of your youth back into government unless the system is changed? I'm not lying. Even if in a corporate, you can't expect to come and change the corporate. Over time, the corporate will make you one of them. Right. So the same happens to the system. If you go in, unless the whole system is changed and made more productive and more corporatized, you all are not going to progress. So I think that's a mindset in our culture as well. We aspire for these safe titles. But I must say that on a positive note, I see there are more young kids who want to be entrepreneurs and who try their hands at startups. Because I guess they'd like to be their own boss in some way. So there's positivity, but I think there's much more. In corporate, you could find them to bring that energy.
Thanks, ma'am. And you brought us almost to an interesting point leading up to the next question that I'm going to ask you. And we sort of try to avoid this question on our programs. But since our crowd is a more varied today, I thought I'll ask this question from you as well. The knowledge of the current affairs, the politics that is happening around us here as a country, how important are these things for the youth to have an understanding, to make decisions, to think of career opportunities, educational opportunities? Do you as a person encourage people to be aware of such things, or are these things that are not really necessary and are they distracting?
I think you need to, but you have to get it from the right sources, right? Why are we struggling today to do this? Why are we in this position? It is not this government or previous government. It has come through long years of wrong policy, because they do the politically right policy versus economically right thing. And where do people play a part? Because we listen, we protest for the slightest thing. We don't know the economic impact. So the real reality today is that our reserves are going down economically. Our import is more than our export. So we don't have enough currency. So with that, our rupee is weak. Whatever we import, whatever we are trying to get down, food, whichever, it's going to cost more. And eventually it may not be even available because we don't have a fund. But so what do we need to correct it? We need to do certain drastic things to become a more efficient country. We have to increase exports. We have to go into more domestic manufacturing. But the most important thing is, where do we spend our money? Whatever is revenue we are spending, there are state assets which are being spent. Where are we being inefficient? So we have to make sure that we become more efficient. And if you take any state enterprise and say that, look, do you measure your number of productive hours? How efficient are you? You'll have a strike. If you see the Colombo port, if there is something wrong, there's a strike. So the problem is, we by allowing all that to happen, our country becomes inefficient. So people have to understand why these policies are needed. And not only the people, even the opposition has to support. So I would urge all of us to not listen to take the effort to understand the fundamentals of what's happening and why it's happening, and how we can as citizens support the right thing versus the politically right thing, politically instigated thing. So you need knowledge, and sadly we get swayed quickly by somebody's opinion. I urge people to have their own opinion. And it's simple economics, right? If you have a bank account, you have a business, you are selling, you're spending more than you sell. And you are not, and you're keeping the same structure, you're having same overheads. Something has to give if you want to come out of it. So that's the same thing. So while the government is trying to get some kind of relief in the interim, we have to understand, we have to go through tough times for the next couple of years before we come out of it. It's in life. Sometimes you have to buckle up. I've done that when I didn't have to start life again. I mean, I remember there were times in my personal economics was, we would go to a supermarket to buy stuff or something like that. And my son would say, do you have money for me to put the last chocolate or whatever? And some days I'll say, I don't have the money. You buckle up. You learn to go by bus, but you do that for a short term so that you have a bigger picture. You do that. It's the same thing, but I would urge all the young people, understand, take the effort to understand the dynamics of our economy, of our country, and the private sector as well as the state sector, and see in your way, how can you help support the country to develop?
And today we heard that there are KPIs being introduced to the government sector as well. We'll have to wait and see how that unfolds.
That's a good start. Good start.
Yes. We'll move on, madam. With like 10 minutes remaining, I want to get a few things, get a few quick questions in. Now, we are talking about motivating ourselves and motivating people to unite them to reach a common goal. Now, as we can discuss, let's talk about you as a person from the position of a leader with the people that you are working with. You have at one point may have had the requirement to prove to your senior management or the people who take decisions in your organization that you are a person who can do this role. So therefore, take me or elevate me to this position and then perform in that capacity and then thereafter upgrade yourself. How does one prove to another person, maybe a superior, maybe a peer, how do you show that person that I am capable of doing something? Is it by like doing the normal 8-5 or doing the basic things that are required? Do we have to do more? What is your opinion?
So I think, Chaturanga, while you were asking this question, I was thinking, whom did I ever try to prove? Honestly, I was not trying to prove to anybody, but I was proving to myself that I can do well. So it was a simple thing of whatever you do, do it excellently, do well. In that journey, of course, I had to be navigating peers. I had to be navigating my team. And then I needed to adjust my personality or the way I lead. So I guess what happened was the first time I moved out of the role from function into an MD of transportation, there I had to prove to my team who were older than me and more experienced than me, why I was put as an MD. Because frankly, they said, look, one of them should have been it. And I didn't get offended. I just told them, look, give me 6 months. Let's see whether I bring value to you. And in before 6 months, I said, definitely they see what I bring to the table. And what did I, and I guess I had confidence. I learned, not that there is no politics. When there are peers, definitely there is competition. But I learned to leave noise off. And I just learned to focus on setting very high goals for myself, right? And I chase behind that. And that is not to impress my bosses, but that is a sense of pride for me to be so that we are doing well. And maybe that I wanted to be doing well within the environment of a group, right? So transportation, we put an aggressive plan, trying to execute, getting into new spaces. And what was it that would have been seen is, okay, she's taking bold decisions, she's getting about and getting the team to achieve, right? So they saw some results. And when the next role was given, I didn't see it coming. It was just a conversation. While doing this, can you take over pharmaceutical? And I was like, okay, and there the job was not to do anything, but to get the teams to bring their best, their A game out because they felt the team was demotivated. So I guess when I was told to bring the best out of the team, I focused on that. Gave them direction, told them to aspire for themselves, also aspire more. And it's again internal. It's just a sense of pride. You don't want to be average. When you take on a role, you want to be better than, you want to be the best. So in pharma, I wanted them to be the leader by far without being this kind of market share. When you focus on that, and you achieve it, people start noticing it. So, and that's what I give as advice. Focus on how you can make this role bigger and better every single day. And while you're focusing on that, people start noticing you. You don't have to ask for it, right? And whether you're doing a marketing on role, try to be, how can you be the best marketer there? Or you're doing an engineering role, how can you be the best engineer? How can you bring new thoughts to the table? It's not for credit, but for you to feel that, you know, you've done excellently well. And somebody will notice it. And when they notice it and they give you the next opportunity, take it, because there's something they see in you that you don't see, because you're enjoying the journey and you're going on this journey. So next was, of course, the group CEO role. So I guess self-motivation on a title, I would encourage you to aspire for more. I encourage you to have ambition. But let that ambition not be a title or the next title. Let that ambition be for you to elevate your thought, get some new knowledge, get some new skill set, and maybe conquer a new project or something like that. When those outcomes are seen, automatically you kind of get noticed and you're given the next opportunity.
Absolutely. Now, to zoom out a bit, now when you sort of take a look at corporate structure, when you take a look at the hierarchy, you realize, okay, this is the role of a manager, this is the role of a director, is the role of a MD, and then you realize how big your role is when you like zoom out and see your group CEO of one of the leading companies in the country. And we remember when you received the position, there was a lot of best wishes coming your way. A lot of people spoke about it. And a lot of people were happy, and they saw, you know, the corporate sector of the country opening up and things like that. But then that the other side of it is, it's a lot of pressure. It's a lot of stress. It's not an easy job to do. Your group CEO, as good as it sounds, there is that risk, the responsibility and all of that involved as well. So we have about 5 minutes. How do you manage this? I mean, it's like captaining the Sri Lankan cricket team. The captain has the weight on his shoulders. You can say your selectors, all that is there. But at the end of the day, the person doing the job is the person who is going to take all of the responsibility. You are that person. So how do you handle that? Has it been a stress? Has it been a challenge? How do you view it?
So I would, I kind of thrive in challenges. It has been challenging. It was not a benefit that I came and took over just before when COVID hit. Yeah, right. So I come planning 1 year before, 6 months, 1 year before I knew I was taking over. So I was doing long range planning, and then suddenly I realized 1 month before I take over as deputy CEO, COVID has hit and everything changed. So, and then the next challenge was when the companies were struggling during COVID. Remember, it came through Easter Sundays. We were impacted because of this whole racial card which people had, competition had put in. So when stress is, I kind of, yeah, you could call it stress, but I didn't get stressed, but I was concerned that with all the publicity I got, right, I needed to be able to discharge my job without getting distracted. Because remember, if I don't do well within the first 12 months, the same people who publicly praise me could have killed me and crucified me. And what would that mean to the young girls who aspire to be me or aspire to be another CEO? It would mean that the legacy of this, a woman can't cut it as a CEO. So I knew that, and I switched on to be more focused because I was very firm that I was not going to leave a legacy for the young women to have that a woman can't cut it, right? With that in mind, I needed to switch my strategy and make sure the team, remember when you're CEO, when you're an MD, before that I was an MD, right? I had the entire company within my control. So at Pharma before that, I had about 1,200 employees, logistics and maritime together, another 800. So the 2,000 employees who I was the boss of. When I became group CEO, I had 5 MDs whom I could influence for them to influence their employees, 6,000 employees in the group. So my span of control reduced drastically, right? And I had to influence these 5 people that COVID or no COVID, we have to go out there and make sure that we do right by our customers, bring the new in, drive our core, have growth within that. And we did, and define a 3-year plan. And that was a struggle because I needed them to believe it can be done. And this is moving from a 6% average growth in revenue to double digits, 15-20% growth in revenue. So it's a mindset change to get them to believe that and get their teams to work on it was really, it took a lot of me, but out of me, but I must say at the end, when they all bought into it and they're running with it, it was great. And of course, the last quarter was a tough quarter because we saw commodity prices, our margins getting hit, even though we had revenue growth, our margins like absolutely got hit. And then what's the challenge there? How do I keep the team motivated enough to understand? Just still focus on the right things, right drivers, and continue that, because there's no point crying about things we can't control. I can't control the exchange rate. I'm not an exporter and I don't control global prices, but I can control how I react to all of this. So it's really tough. But what I think I learn is during challenging times, I become calmer and I become more structured in thinking. So I take a, like you said, zoom out. I can take a zoom out and come back calmer. And I become stronger as a leader that time because I'm very mindful. Remember, we are in healthcare, we are in consumer brands, we are manufacturing during the height of COVID. What is the balance of, how do I be strong enough to say balance of, yes, we keep going, but our employees have to be safe. Yes, if there is employees with COVID, how do we react? How do we look after them? How do we ensure the next shift is roster is looked at? So that time you can't be too collaborative. You have to take decisions and say this is how you do it. So I think I become during challenging times, I become a stronger leader as a personality. And when things kind of ease out, I kind of relax and allow them to do and, you know, making decisions and choices and growing. So it is challenging, but that's life, right? Whether it's corporate or personality, personal challenges come in. I guess it's just accepting that this is a new challenge and you'll have to navigate it.
Once again, thank you very much for joining us on Gamed the V-Force and also Amplifier by ISAC Sri Lanka. I'm sure there's a lot more that we can talk about, but with the time, we covered a lot of areas that we could talk about. So I'm sure the participants of this session had a lot to take in, think about, develop themselves, and accommodate any of the information that you have got in some way in your life to become a better person. So once again, madam, thank you very much for joining us and talking to us on today's session.
It was a pleasure, Chaturanga, and thanks to Kamadha and as well as ISAC, and I think Amplify is a brand under that. But it was a pleasure, and I know it's so I'm only giving my view, but look, you all will have your own views. In 10 years, you'll be having your own views. You have learned lessons. You're talking about 50 years of lessons for me. So that's the reason I can't explain. You all might want answers, but eventually you will have your own answers. So it is a pleasure being part of it. Thanks.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you very much once again. And Amplifier by ISAC Sri Lanka for partnering with Gamedha. I'm sure we'll have more eventful and interesting partnerships in the future as well as we move forward. So good luck to Amplifier 21 as well and ISAC Sri Lanka. And for everyone who joined, let's meet next time. Thank you very much.
Bye.
The V-Force Youth Movement.
Leaders for tomorrow.